Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and I'd like to welcome you to this celebratory webinar that is part of the Royal College of Psychiatrists celebration of Black History Month. It's a distinct privilege for me to be chairing this occasion. And when you think about the quality of speakers that we have today, you're in for a treat. So I'd just like to do a bit of housekeeping. We've got lots of questions, I'm sure, that will arise. And we're collating questions in the chat function such that at the point of the Q&A, the panelists will be able to give their full attention to questions. My job is to introduce them, give a brief biography, and give them about 10 minutes each to talk about the great things they've achieved. And hopefully, I'm sure we'll all be inspired by all they've done. I've got a running order. And without further ado, I'm going to try and introduce our first colleague and then take the show off the ground. So the first person to speak today is our own Professor Femi Oyebode. He is a Royal College Lifetime Achievement Award winner of 2016. I think all of us know Professor Oyebode from his work in psychopathology, but I'll read out a brief biography. Femi Oyebode graduated with distinction from the University of Ibadan in 1977. He trained in psychiatry in Newcastle upon Tyne and has been a consultant psychiatrist in Birmingham since 1986. He was appointed honorary professor of psychiatry, University of Birmingham in 1999, and was head of department from 2003 to 2008. He was involved in various roles in college examinations from 1989 to 2005, and was chief examiner from 2002 to 2005. He is currently associate editor of the British Journal of Psychiatry. He's acted as an external examiner at University College Dublin, Kiel, Kuwait, Nottingham, Leeds, Newcastle upon Tyne, Oman, and St. George's, London. He's been visiting professor at Auckland, Ibadan, and Perth. His books include Mind Readings, Literature and Psychiatry, Madness at the Theatre, and Sims, Symptoms in the Mind, Textbook of Descriptive Psychopathology, 4th to 6th editions. He is a published poet. So without further ado, it's my privilege and pleasure to hand over to Professor Femi Oyebode.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Tim, for your kind introduction. And I'm very pleased to be here this afternoon or early evening. And my aim is just to say a little bit about how I've come to be a psychiatrist. And then at the end, to say a little bit about what I hope the future will hold. And I was born in Lagos my father and my mother. My father was studied mathematics and physics, and had trained at the London Met Office as a meteorologist, and worked in Lagos worked to be the deputy director of the Nigerian Meteorological Services, and my mother had trained as a secretary, and she was it's a strange thing to say out loud, but she was the first Black person, first African to be appointed as a secretary by the Barclays Bank in 1960. So that gives you a sense of what my background is. And as a young person, before going to university, my main interest, my preoccupation was with literature. And I suppose it's true to say that I've been self-aware, that I took an interest in poetry since I was 8 years of age, and I've been writing since the age of eight. So my real deep interest and passion, if you wish, has always been literature. And I can remember a discussion with my father in around about 1970, talking about what one might do for a living. And his approach was to say that at least you can do medicine, but in order to do medicine, you've got to be trained at it. Whereas in order to be a writer, you don't need someone else to train you how to do it. And there's no good reason why you couldn't combine writing with medicine. And I suppose that was a kind of a father's way of essentially tricking you and using an adult's way of thinking, a kind of wise wisdom to persuade me to go into medicine. So I went into medicine, in 1972, and already knowing, I suppose, that I wanted to be a psychiatrist, even though I didn't really know what psychiatry was about. And I, being in psychiatry, since 1978. So I did my usual house jobs at the University College Hospital in Ibadan. And in Nigeria, you'd have to train, you have to work what was still called the National Youth Service. And I persuaded the organizers to send me off to the psychiatric hospital. So I did a year of psychiatry in Aro Hospital in Abeokuta, which is the hospital, quite an important hospital, because it was a hospital that Thomas Adeoye Lambo built in Nigeria, which is the first purpose-built psychiatric hospital in Nigeria. And then I've been in the United Kingdom since 1979 and trained in psychiatry in Newcastle upon Tyne. And have to say one or two things about people who were very inspiring to me. And Tolanya Suni, who is now passed away, was the medical superintendent at the Aro Hospital when I was a medical student. He'd moved on by the time I went to work there, but he was a remarkable man. And he was the first clinician, consultant level clinician that I met, who treated the patients as if they were his equals. Of course they were his equals in reality, but he treated them properly. And he treated his staff very well. And I thought that was a memorable, quite an inspiring approach and attitude that he had. And in Newcastle, I was very under the kind of, the support and inspiration of Ken Davison, who's well known in Newcastle. And I worked for Alan Kerr and Hamish McClurland and Kurt Shapira, people who were very thoughtful and very supportive to me. And then I moved to Birmingham, and I think even that is itself is a good story, because I moved to Birmingham, and when I went to meet with the consultants, as one did in those days before the interview, as I walked into Professor Ian Brockington's office, he greeted me in Yoruba. He said, "Akaabo," and I was completely thrown. I couldn't believe. I'd lived in Britain since 1979. I'd never heard a British person speak Yoruba. So I had to ask him, how come you can speak it with such perfect accent? Because Yoruba is a tonal language. And so that was very interesting, because he himself had worked as a senior registrar who'd been sent to Ibadan from Hammersmith to study. He was a cardiologist at the time before changing over. So that gives you a kind of background of what how I came to be a psychiatrist and come to be a consultant. In terms of contribution, that's always very difficult to say what one's contribution has been. And I suppose that one of the first things I want to say is the kind of idea that it is possible to have a contribution which goes across the board. So I've worked in medical management. I was medical director for a number of years in my trust. And I've worked at senior level as an academic, being the academic head of department of psychiatry in Birmingham for a number of years. And then, of course, I was chief examiner in the Royal College of Psychiatrists, and I'm still involved in publications at the college. So there's something to be said for having a kind of broad interest, a kind of which is personally, I think, is very enriching, which makes it possible to continue to work. And I've been in medicine now, as a practicing doctor since 1977. So to be able to continue to work and without being burnt out, continue to be interested, to be able to refresh oneself and to feel that you're able to continue to make a contribution. In terms of the kind of academic contribution, I suppose that I regard myself as a kind of scholarly psychiatrist rather than a kind of empirical researcher, even though I have done quite a bit of empirical research in my time. But I regard myself as a theoretical thinker. And of course that makes sense, because I am a psychopathologist, and there are not very many psychopathologists who regard themselves, not very many psychiatrists who regard themselves as psychopathologists, but I am one of the few who regards himself as a psychopathologist. So I hope that my lasting kind of contribution to psychiatry will be the kind of how important it is to have psychopathology at the center of our concern, to ensure that we continue to think very clearly about the nature of abnormal experiences that our patients have, and to remind ourselves of the centrality of empathy in the kind of pursuit of understanding of psychopathology, because you, in order to have a proper grasp of psychopathology, you have to be able to empathize with the patient. You have to be able to stand in their shoes and understand how it is that they're experiencing the things that they're experiencing. Finally, I just want to say, of course, that another area of my life, of course, is the influence of literature and how you use literature to teach medical students, to teach trainees, and also to help practicing psychiatrists and practicing doctors to have a sense of understanding of the life of the patients that they serve. And I have personally found that very, very enriching. So thank you very much for inviting me to contribute to today's webinar, and I'm very delighted to be here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Oyebode. It's really encouraging to hear your story and the biography of how you became a psychiatrist. Before I hand over to the next person, just to, out of interest for those listening, about 10 years after Professor Oyebode graduated in 1987, a young Tim Ojo was a medical student in University of Lagos, and he too also knew that I was going to do psychiatry before he left the country. And I had the privilege of having Professor Asuni as my professor of psychiatry in Lagos before he retired. So there's a rich history of West Africans, Anglophone West Africans, being involved in psychiatry. And there's a good book called Black Skin, White Coats by Matthew Heaton. It's a fantastic elucidation of the history of psychiatry in Nigeria. And for those of you who are interested in psychiatry from a global perspective, it's a book I'd recommend. But without further ado, it's not about me, it's about our next speaker. And it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Mosun Fapohunda. She's a consultant psychiatrist and the founding member of Black Women in Health. I'll just give you a brief bio and allow her to do her magic. Dr. Mosun Fapohunda is a consultant psychiatrist and medical lead for quality at Hertfordshire Partnership University NHS Foundation Trust. She contributes actively to teaching and training of future generation of psychiatrists. She supports the GMC through her associate role. She has led health campaigns within communities and organizations on suicide prevention, reduction of stigma associated with having a mental illness, and improving access to mental health care. Dr. Fapohunda is the Welfare Secretary of the Association of Black Psychiatrists in the UK and lead for the psychiatric arm of Black Women in Health. She hopes that these organizations will provide a formal platform for harnessing the rich knowledge of culture, experience, and expertise of Black psychiatrists for the benefit of members, as well as the care of our very diverse UK patient population. So without further ado, it's my privilege and pleasure to hand you over to Dr. Mosun Fapohunda.
Good evening, everyone. It is a great pleasure to be part of the webinar this afternoon, and thank you for inviting me. It's also very great to be speaking among highly esteemed senior colleagues like we have on the webinar. My task this afternoon is very simple. It's a call for action, and particularly in relation to Black psychiatrists. We've all been contributing in our individual capacities, but you'd agree with me that a collective effort will take us a lot further than our individual efforts. Concerning my presentation this afternoon, I've split it into two different parts. The first part will talk about my experience in my journey and the area I want to highlight in terms of finding a female role model, a Black mentor at the time of my training. I'll depict this through a short video, a 4-minute video that I'd like you to all watch. And the second part of the presentation will be when I'll say what my hopes are for the future and how I hope that platforms such as Association of Black Psychiatrists UK and Black Women in Health can help move the agenda for mental health inequalities forward. Thank you. Katie, you can begin the video now.
My name is Mosun Fapohunda. I'm a consultant psychiatrist and medical lead for quality, working at Hertfordshire Partnership University NHS Trust. The Black History Month has been an opportunity for us to appreciate and recognize the contributions of Black people to the society, and in this case, to psychiatry as a specialty. It has also been a time for personal reflection about our individual journeys and how we can improve things for the future. We've had a lot of discussion about racial inequalities, differential attainments, and possible solutions. What I particularly want to highlight from my personal experience and journey is a difficulty I had in the days in identifying Black female role models that I could approach for support and mentoring. And it is on that basis that my hope for the future is to attempt to change the narrative for future aspiring female psychiatrists. I am presenting a pool of Black women in psychiatry who are making significant contributions, and I'm also happy to support the college and future aspiring psychiatrists to bridge that gap. Thank you for watching.
Hello, my name is Dr. Afuokwe Ndo. I'm a consultant psychiatrist in general adult psychiatry in Walsall, which is under the Black Country Healthcare NHS Foundation Trust. Thank you.
My name is Abisola Ogundalu. I'm a consultant liaison psychiatrist in the West Cheshire region.
My name is Lola Odebi. I'm a consultant psychiatrist in intellectual disability in Hertfordshire.
Hello, my name is Tuyin Omojuwa. I'm a consultant psychiatrist working in Oxley's NHS Foundation Trust, South London.
My name is Olushola Wonogu. I'm a consultant forensic psychiatrist working in London.
Hi, my name is Dr. Femi Oyebode. I'm a consultant psychiatrist in Greenwich in Southeast London.
Hello, my name is Abimbola Fadipe. I'm a consultant all-day psychiatrist and deputy medical director, and I work in London.
Hello, I'm Dr. Chinua Benoit, consultant forensic psychiatrist and clinical director for Forensic and Rehab Services, Derbyshire Healthcare Foundation Trust. Thank you.
I'm Buki Ademo. I'm a consultant psychiatrist and medical director.
Hi, my name is Dr. Mayaki. I'm a consultant in general adult psychiatry in Herefordshire. I work part-time in the NHS and part-time in the private sector. It's an absolute pleasure to be a part of this.
Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Uju Ugochukwu. I'm a consultant psychiatrist working in early intervention in psychosis and the youth service in Norfolk and Suffolk NHS Foundation Trust. I hope this month's Black History events inspires real progress for all of us. Thank you.
My name is Margaret Obedehama. I'm a dual general adult and old age consultant psychiatrist working in Greenwich, London.
For most people, these celebrations and discussions will probably come to an end on the 31st of October. But as for the Association of Black Psychiatrists UK, the Black Women in Health, the Black Women in Psychiatry, this piece of work would continue to give the much desired hope to future generations and the diverse range of service users we support. Thank you.
Thank you, Katie, for the video. So the next part of my presentation is a call to action. And this call to action is to all Black psychiatrists, males or females. I know that I have shown a video that contains mainly females, but the Association of Black Psychiatrists UK is an association that encompasses all Black psychiatrists of all grades. It's a call to action because we have said a lot about mental health inequalities in attainment, but it's time for us now to stand up and be counted and to contribute to improving the situation for our Black patients and also for ourselves. So I am trying to highlight two particular benefits of being a member of the association. There will be benefits for individual members and also contribution to our different organizations and also to service users and carers. So benefits to individual members, we would include our welfare team that would support psychiatrists of all grades, including international medical graduates who are new to the UK, people on the MTI program, on the international medical fellowships, just helping you settle in the UK generally and teaching you what we've gone through, supporting you to embed in the society and not make the mistakes that we have made. Obviously, examinations are an area that are held closely to the heart of trainees. We know that there's been differential attainments in our CAS exams, especially for IMGs and BAME doctors. The core knowledge is not a problem. Most doctors have the same core knowledge. It's the procedural skills, the ability to apply the knowledge that usually makes people fall short. So our training will basically be directed at supporting people to improve those procedural skills. Our SAS doctors would ensure you feel valued and appreciated and will support you with the CSER route as well into being consultants. For the consultants level, it's important that we're supported into putting ourselves forward for leadership and management roles, because we need to be at the table. You stand more chance of being able to make a contribution and make a change and contribute to policies and changes that are required in the system if you are on the discussion table. How do you get to the discussion table? Putting yourself forward and having the required competences. Obviously, the Royal College of Psychiatrists has leadership and management schemes, but we're also going to be liaising with the Faculty of Medical Leadership and Management and making sure that we have the training we require. We have an international liaison officer that will help links to international organizations, for example, diaspora committees within the college, help African countries, train their psychiatrists, you know, help upcoming psychiatrists. Some populations in some African countries would have one single psychiatrist covering thousands and thousands of the population suffering mental illness. So we can make changes in that area as well. In terms of supporting our organizations and supporting the Royal College of Psychiatrists, we know from figures that only 2% of committee members at the college are of Black origin. So it's really important that we begin to see the college ourselves as part of the college, getting involved in various ways. There's so many ways in which we can get involved in the college activities. There are quality improvement activities, research, there's audits, there's patient and carer engagements, there's a Choose Psychiatry, encouraging medical students and foundation doctors and recruitment into psychiatry. There's so many different ways in which we can get involved. And of course, we have the Presidential Leads for Race and Equality in the persons of Lade Smith and Rajesh Mohan that we can liaise with in that regard as well. I'd like to refer you to two documents. That is the Advancing Mental Health Equality and the Patient and Carer Race Equality Framework. So this is part of is commissioned by NHS England and is a way of supporting commissioners for the 5-year forward view and NHS long-term plans. And this is one way in which you can get involved in our local communities, running focus groups, distributing surveys. Research has shown that Black people who suffer mental illness and their carers and families engage more in research if the researchers are also Black. This is one reason for us to get involved. Organizations are also now required to have their own competency tools to check their patient and carer experience and satisfaction. So we are expert by experience in the sense that we have a rich knowledge of culture. We can advise about the cultural aspects that may serve as barriers to our Black psychiatric patients getting engaged with the services. There's a lot of fear. If we read the document that's relating to breaking the cycle of fear, there's a lot of reasons why Black people who suffer mental illness may not want to be engaged with the service. Some people feel that they're going to be injected, they're going to be sectioned, they're going to be locked up for life. They're the ones that are most likely to be restrained. We know all the figures. We know all the data. We know all the research. So the call this evening is quite simple. It's for Black psychiatrists who have this knowledge, the expertise, to come together and nurse ourselves and be able to make positive contributions, improving the mental health inequalities for all patients who suffer mental illness, or in particularly Black mental health patients and their carers and families. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Fapohunda, for your stirring exhortation about what we need to be doing with allies to make sure that the patients and professionals of Black backgrounds are able to contribute to their fullest as we go forward. And obviously we're hoping that most of the call to actions you made, people will pick up on that and contribute effectively. Having said that, it's a privilege to introduce our next panelist. It's very difficult to know where to start because this person achieved so much, but I think the single most important thing in a way is that Dr. Aggrey Burke was the first African Caribbean psychiatrist to be appointed to the NHS in London way back in the 70s. I've got about 23 pages of information I could share with you, but I think that'll be doing him a disservice. I thought a way of just putting some context around what he has achieved is to give you some of the committee memberships or awards he's had. He had a right back from the 50s, a Marcus Garvey scholarship in 1955, a special award from the Jamaican National and Daily Gleaner in 1995. He was made an honorary member of the African Caribbean Mental Health Network in 1997. He was given a presidential medal from Royal College in 2020. And thinking about a way to show respect, there's a saying in Yoruba, which is my mother tongue, that the horses behind in the race look at the forerunner to understand what the path is. And therefore it's safe to say on Dr. Burke's shoulders, many of us have risen to become consultants and practitioners in mental health. So it's a great privilege to invite him to say a few things on this panel. Thank you.
It is indeed a wonderful pleasure to be sitting among this group of Black people, Black professionals, Black psychiatrists. I guess when I was born, the concept of a Black psychiatrist was a distant one. And here we are now in a forum in which we have the past president of the American Psychiatric Association. Very welcome, Altha. And notable figures from here in Britain. There is this issue as to why Black psychiatry, and it's troubled me from birth. Why Black psychiatry? Are we chosen because we are damned in the world? And so we have this real conflict, and Fanon from Martinique, he tried to look at this because, you know, I was brought up in an English environment, totally British environment, Scottish names. They were the people who ran the estates. The names of the villages were British names. You would go from into Birmingham. We don't have Birmingham, but we have new names. I live in a town, in a village called Malvern in Jamaica. So we are brought up in this grim reality of rejecting Africa, and what great joy there is in finding myself in the middle of an African siesta today. We were brought up to reject all things African and to pride ourselves in all things European. So we were damned. We were damned. And yet today there is this opportunity, and thank you very much for inviting me to share some of the challenges and aspirations and hopes with you. I have been reading this interesting document by Doreen Lawrence, Baroness Doreen Lawrence, one of our number, who's been looking at the issue of COVID and how it's affected Black, Asian, and minority ethnic populations. And she's written this document called An Avoidable Crisis to highlight some of the difficulties we continue to face. And COVID has brought them home to us in a big way. The overexposure. There was this, I think she was from Ghana, a nurse in the close to London, I think in the Luton area, whose father died from COVID. And then she was pregnant and she gave birth to a child, her child. She worked right up until the birth and then she got COVID and died. And I said to myself, could it be that in that setting, no one really came to terms with the idea that she was vulnerable and that she should not have been working at the time? And that vulnerability, was it to do with anything else but being Black? And so you have this great crisis. Can we rescue our own when we see our own in need of rescue? Or are we part of a general population? And I think the latter, we are part of a general population where we must look out for everyone, regardless of race, creed, gender. We must look out for everyone. But that is the problem. We don't look out for everyone, even in our setting in the psychiatric field. We don't. And that is a problem. And why don't we? Is it because of our upbringing? Or because the society says we shouldn't? How can we move forward? I've been thinking about how it is that in the work I've done, it's been really very challenging. And in January, we'll be having the 40th anniversary of the New Cross Fire. The New Cross Fire was a grim reality for us. 13 youngsters died in that fire. In a situation in which a town in London, one of London boroughs, and the population there, they were complaining about these Caribbean people having night parties, making noise. And then there was this party for 15-year-olds, and a fire started, and mayhem, and 13 died. In one subsequently. And we got in there and we did counseling for those families and the families of those who attended and were injured. That was a great challenge for us. But we were left with a society in conflict. And the conflict of the society was such that two inquests were held and nothing found. So 13 dead, nothing said, was the popular view at the time. But it was a great bit of work. And one of the things that surprised me about my work during that period was that in my own job in London, I think two colleagues showed some empathy. Two colleagues showed some interest in the fact that for about 9 months, most nights I was down there in New Cross. In fact, some of my colleagues dissuaded me from being involved, but that didn't work. It was an attempt to dissuade me. So we have these realities, and currently we have COVID and we had that reality. And currently we are in this, and Mosun has talked very, very wonderfully about the challenge to bring in people into the profession. And we need to bring in people who are Black, who are Asian, who are Chinese, who are white. But we have a real problem because the most deprived sector in our community, Bangladeshi, Pakistani, and the Caribbean. We are the deprived sectors. And, you know, I do always want to see the good things come forward. Can my colleagues in psychiatry not understand that if you're comparing two groups and one is three or four times more deprived than the other, you must adjust for that. And it gets even more profoundly difficult to understand that the group of people that I'm part of that seek to, you know, we fear being abandoned. Slavery was a period of being abandoned at home. In Africa, in a sense, we were being abandoned by, in all the stages. And surprisingly, in the research done, among, for so many papers on how we are the most schizophrenic, the most in prison, the most excluded from school, three times more likely to be in care of the social services. You know, the youngsters, the Lamy report said, things are getting worse, not better. So we have a situation. And yet my colleagues do not diagnose borderline personality disorder among our people. And I wonder, why is this? Is this something that, you know, they feel that we shouldn't have? Or is it because we don't have? Well, the American studies, the match studies in America state very clearly that race may not be a significant factor determining outcome or likelihood of contracting borderline personality disorder, but other studies say it might be more. And by being abandoned so many times, you know, abandoned, estate to estate, soil, you know, and if you make any complaint, you don't get it right. We are predisposed to be borderline personality disorder. And so what seems to have been happening is that somehow our colleagues have not been able to get into that issue, that we are not simply behaving badly. We are reacting, we are being angry, we are being, because of the fear of being abandoned. That is the issue. And so where do we go? My one other great interest has been working with the mothers of these children who are vulnerable. And so the mothers are vulnerable and the children are vulnerable. And we've been trying to prevent these children getting into the care system. But unfortunately, deprivation really makes a very great mark on one's capacity to function. These mothers are mothers who get up at four. They go to work. Some of them haven't got time to feed their children before the children go out to school. And so these children are sometimes quite vulnerable. And we've been trying to work, with social workers in this area and with wonderful women who have set up children's homes. But, you know, there is this problem that if a child is damaged by whatever process, abuse or neglect or whatever it is, it's difficult to rescue the child unless you have some sense of constancy in that child's life. And so I don't know, I'm still looking at the figures there to try and make some sense of what can we do to rescue children across the board, but in the Black community, it's probably three times more likely than in any other. One of the things which gives me great pleasure is the Caribbean and how we followed Professor Lambo, Professor Asuni. We had Professor Bobran and my dear friend, Professor Hickling died recently. And in Trinidad, we have Professor Hutchinson. And back in Jamaica, we have Professor Abel. And so we have built up something, and in African states, they're building up something, or colleagues in South Africa, Zoli Ratamani, I went there and lectured at his hospital. So we are building. And this is a great challenge for us to continue building. It's a world which we can do it. We will do it, and we will do it together. Thank you a lot for inviting me today.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Burke. You have given a magisterial overview of the points we need to attend to in fighting for greater equality, all the traditional historical issues that we've had to overcome. And more importantly, I was very touched by you ending on a positive, affirmative note, hopeful for the future. And that leads us to the last panelist before the Q&A. It's my pleasure to introduce Altha J. Stewart, MD. Dr. Altha J. Stewart is a Senior Associate Dean, Community Health Engagement, UT Health Science Center. She served as the 145th President of the American Psychiatric Association, the first African-American ever elected to this position. She's a native of Memphis. Dr. Stewart received her medical degree from Temple University Medical School and an honorary degree from her alma mater, Christian Brothers University. She's the past president of the Black Psychiatrists of America and recipient of the Lifetime Achievement Award in 2017. Thank you very much, Dr. Stewart. Over to you.
Well, thank you very much. I am humbled to have followed my friend Aggrey. I will remember in the future, Dr. Burke, that I will never follow you as a speaker again. I was riveted and began rewriting my remarks in the middle of your conversation because I realized while I recognize the great honor and the invitation to join with you today, I now realize that it is as important as anything I have ever done to share some things with this group that may come as a bit of a surprise to some, but hopefully not all, that I think will help to move towards that positive vision that you have suggested for our future. As you heard in the introduction, I am a past president of the American Psychiatric Association, the first African American to lead that organization in its 100 and at that point 74 year history, and proudly visited with some of you at the RCP Congress during my term leading into the presidency. And was honored then to also deliver a talk. So I bring you greetings from your RCP sister organization, the American Psychiatric Association, which I led proudly, but also from your brothers and sisters who are members of the Black Psychiatrists of America, who want very much to align with the Association of Black Psychiatrists UK, and also from our colleagues in both the National Medical Association, who are psychiatrists, which is our Black Doctors Association here in the US, and the psychiatrists who are members of the larger American Medical Association, but who serve a valuable role, play a valuable role there, representing the interest of people of African descent throughout medicine. I am truly humbled by the privilege of being with you here today. And I thought I would try and use my time doing three things. I'm gonna try very hard to stick within the time limit, but I'm still sort of excited by all of the speakers who spoke before me. The first thing is to make sure that we all understand many of the similarities that I understand now to be part of your lives as professionals in the psychiatric community and my life as a professional in the psychiatric community here. The next thing is to talk a little bit about how some of those things relate to some of the work that we, I think, need to do. And then to finally revisit something that I heard in the session last week, the inaugural meeting of the Association of Black Psychiatrists UK, around some of the tips and try to reflect from the perspective of a US practicing psychiatrist, how some of those things create natural bridges for our work together in doing this around the world, this work around the world. So I will start with some of the similarities. Those who knew me back during my presidential term may remember that I think to expand our presence, our role, our footprint, if you will, in the global arena with respect to psychiatry, and specifically with respect to psychiatry as it impacted people of color, as we describe it. And so it fit very neatly into my own professional interest around diversity and equity and inclusion throughout the professional spectrum for individuals, psychiatrists, as well as into the work that we do with the folks who come to us for services, our patients and their families and the communities in which they live. And so when I visited before, I believe my topic was adverse childhood experiences in the US and some of the work that we were doing on that. And that resonated quite nicely with Dr. Burke's comments just now about that sense of abandonment, that sense of rejection, that sense of we are the damned, and the belief in many communities in the United States, and it sounds like in some communities there as well, that sets the stage for everything that happens to us going forward, and that a part of the work of us as psychiatrists is to begin to unravel those feelings, those thoughts, those behaviors, and create new narratives for people as part of better diagnostic capabilities, understanding more the impact of the social, what we now call the social determinants of health, on the overwhelmingly damaging psychological distress that many in our communities are faced with. And as I thought about this, I realized that between the two, the US and the UK, we celebrate Black History Month in February, which, as you recall, is the shortest month. You have opted for, in the UK, Black History Month being one of the longer months. At least it's got 31 days. And in your area, you talk about Black, Asian, minority, ethnic populations. We have captured those things in everything from biracial to underrepresented in medicine, to minority underrepresented, to people of color, to Black indigenous people of color. We have a range of acronyms and labels, if you will, that we use. But essentially, we're talking about people who have been historically disenfranchised, who have, as Dr. Burke so eloquently described, who have been in existence in lands where we are the underserved, but primarily and disproportionately impacted by structures, including healthcare, that do not serve our best interest. And I am absolutely touched by the descriptions of some of the experiences from last week's conference meeting and panelists, and also today, as to the similarities in the experiences in the areas of training and education and the kinds of things that you are exposed to in those settings that resonate with me, because it's similar to the experiences that we have here. In the area of clinical services and some of the challenges that you face as it relates to how people access care, what kind of care they get when they arrive, where you are practicing, and what limitations there may be on the kinds of services that you can provide, the impact of being Black in a situation where treating Black patients is not a high priority for everyone, and certainly not treating them in a manner that suggests we are all aiming for the quality standard that we would want for ourselves and our families. And then, of course, the area of research is so rife with the undercurrent and often overt aspects of denying the disparities, denying the presence of inequities, denying the role that we in the psychiatric community across the board play in shoring up structures that are destructive to the psychological health and well-being of the people we serve. And then the final is the whole challenge in the community, and it is happening around the world. But again, the similarities with your experiences with disproportionate contact with law enforcement, disproportionate and overrepresentation of Blacks in the category generally of serious mental illness, which is something that requires almost giving up on someone, as opposed to those things that are directly related to our life experiences, the stressors that we face based on race, racism, the structures that are not working in our best interest. And for us, a longstanding and challenging issue, the general misunderstanding of the prevalence of misdiagnosis amongst Black patients with mental illness versus their white counterparts, which has historically done a disservice to those patients and created an environment where they are not getting the highest quality care and certainly not the standard of care that they deserve. And so it is that sort of understanding of the language that we share around these experiences, understanding the similarities in our experiences as professionals, as psychiatrists, that I come to the point where I too have and share Dr. Burke's hope for the future. When you started to talk about the role of literature here in the US, over the last year or so, certainly within the last 10 months, many of us in the psychiatric community who are Black have sought refuge in the literature of our people. Everybody from James Baldwin to Toni Morrison to Maya Angelou and others who spoke to the issues facing Black people at a time when psychiatry was not listening. And so we are now almost ravenous in our efforts to begin to create an environment where we can be comfortable and help our communities be comfortable, that these are issues that we have written about before, that we understand from other perspectives, and that we can now layer on top some of our psychiatric expertise, understanding, and skill as part of the community educational effort, if you will, to help people understand some of the strategies, some of the techniques, some of the ways that we both build resilience within our community, but also do not ignore the reality that there are things happening that are specifically contributing to their stress, their psychological distress, and the fact that the long, hard battle ahead of us around social justice, racial injustice, and combating that, and reducing and eliminating disparities in healthcare and the inequity in our healthcare system that was laid bare by the COVID-19 pandemic, that all of these are things that we as a people, as a community of people, are certainly willing to work together on, and that we as psychiatrists bring some unique skills to this party, if you will, that will help people not feel damned and abandoned and rejected. And that's part of our job. That is right in the center of our wheelhouse, if you will. And so I reflect back now as part of the hopeful part of this to some of the things that I learned last week in the inaugural meeting that I want to just comment and sort of reflect as I heard it as a US psychiatrist. The talking to members, we have to have those challenging conversations both within our communities with people who are non-psychiatrists, but also within the psychiatric community. I am so happy to have heard about the creation of the Association of Black Psychiatrists UK. it made my day when I saw the announcement, and I immediately tweeted that out, and I immediately contacted the folks at the Black Psychiatrists of America and encouraged them to please connect with that group and have this conversation about our shared experiences across this vast global community. And I hope that that connection will develop and be maintained so that we can share and learn from each other. I think that expanded knowledge and understanding of how much of this we share will help all of us understand and better deal with it over time. The second thing is the offering of support across the board for these shared experiences. There are things that I believe you will be able to help us understand, not only because you operate within a different kind of healthcare system, but also because you reflect a representation, a global representation of people across the diaspora who are dealing in a place and living and working in a place where we all understand the principles of white supremacy, the understanding of colonialism and its continuing impact on us, the joining together of people from different cultures as a community of concerned individuals who share the common goal of improving the psychological health and well-being of our people. I think there is something there that we offer each other across this cultural divide, if you will, that will be very helpful. I resonated with the suggestion that we all take a look at the core curriculum of how we train and are training that next generation. I am certain that we have some shared experiences around the kinds of things that my generation of myself and Aggrey and Femi and others that where we trained and what we learned is very different in this world of young people who grew up in the digital era, who understand devices much better than I will and how to use all of that stuff and the impact of social media as a means of communicating and disseminating information. Those are things that I understand, but I am nowhere near as adept at as some of my young colleagues. And how do we fold those skills into the training and learning of the next generation that already has a basic foundation for that and understands the power of it, both the power for good as well as the power for not good, let's say. And that kind of a review deserves an understanding across these cultures that we inhabit. And then finally, the notion that we are all now consigned, if you will, to the task of we must address and advance the cause of equality, equity, and removing disparities when it comes to mental health for people of African descent, wherever they are in the globe. We are all charged with that. That is our duty, our responsibility as people, as humans, as a member of the larger global society. And we who are psychiatrists and who are also Black, we understand better than most the significance of this work and its impact on the people who look like us, that we grew up with, that we care about, that we treat on a daily basis. And we understand better than most how much they deserve for us to put in the work to make the change that is necessary to improve the services we offer and the services that they receive. I will leave you with something that helps me, and especially over the last 10 months has helped me to keep in perspective those things, those days when I am really feeling like this is not working, we are not making any headway. I am reminded that one of my favorite authors, of course, is Maya Angelou. And there's a saying that she has made popular in my lifetime around never underestimate the power that one person can have. Because if you do, then you've never spent the night with a mosquito. And being from the South, where mosquitoes are very prevalent, I understand the power in that statement. And I want to leave you with that kind of power. Find reflected in your own backgrounds, your culture, something that reminds you we stay proximate to the problem. We continue to look for opportunities to maintain both our joy and the joy of those around us, even during the darkest, most difficult time, and that we all give ourselves just a little grace during these challenging times, that we are in this for the long haul and that we must continue working together. I'm going to close there and leave us plenty of time for questions. And again, thank you for the opportunity to be with you today. Thank you for inviting your American cousin to be a part of today's program. And thank you for the wisdom that you are sharing with me and that I will be passing on to others. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Altha. I'm sure you'll join me, colleagues on the webinar, to thank Professor Oyebode, Dr. Fapohunda, Dr. Burke, and Dr. Stewart. It's been fantastic to hear the expanse of wisdom. So without further ado, it's my task now to hand over to Dr. Lade Smith, who's going to chair the Q&A session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tim. So, wow, it's been quite a special hour, I'm sure you'd agree. And now's the opportunity for all of you out there to, you've made comments, and I have to say the comments are phenomenal. And I think that we'll be collating those and sharing those with our panelists, because you've all been so inspiring. Thank you so much. So we have a few questions, and if you have any more questions, please put them in the Q&A. So there's a question here from someone who is anonymous, but I think this question could have been posed by any and every Black doctor or Brown doctor, certainly in the UK, and I'm sure much similar thing happens in America. The question is this: how does one tackle open racism from patients? I see patients who are obviously unwell, who verbally lash out on African staff, and I think I've seen this with certainly my South Asian colleagues, calling us names with racial slurs. One in particular actually said that we come here because we aren't being burned anymore, that we should be tied up and burnt. I had another person follow me around the ward, calling me names, going into the dining room where I was having dinner, saying that I'd stolen the food I'd eaten. I was really hurt and felt helpless. And I think we've all had that feeling. Is there any sort of, and this is for any panelist who might want to make comment, but, and maybe people might want to say something in the chat too. Is there any sort of support that's in place for staff when we get such patients? And really importantly, can I refuse to see them? So I don't know who wants to answer that first. So Tim's nodding his head, but Tim, you're not quite panelist actually. So I'm gonna ask Aggrey actually, if you have anything to say. I think you are the elder statesman here.
Oh, thanks. In my practice of psychiatry, I started in Trinidad, where half the population is South Asian and half African in origin, because our Africanness in the Caribbean is very mixed up as well. I had a good time in Trinidad. I actually loved it tremendously. And I love the idea of working across cultures. That seemed to be the most challenging bit of it, because the mannerisms and the attitudes change. Then I went back to Jamaica, and Jamaica is again a very curious society, because the language groups differ in Jamaica. One group speaks mainly Creole and one group speaks English. And most people understand Creole, we call it Patois. And then England. And I trained in medicine in England too. And I have had a curious time in England. I haven't really faced racism from patients. It's been a very curious time. I've worked in rural England a little bit, in Birmingham a little bit, and in London, in a privileged situation at first, and then in a community situation. So I am not that well equipped to deal with it. One thing one would say in these few instances, two or three, four, zero tolerance was my position, actually. Because if one varies, if one moves away from that, you're really setting yourself up, I think. And so one has to, you can't give it to your junior and say, this one don't like me, so look after him for me. You can't do that. Because in the end, I am responsible as the consultant, and I must take full responsibility for all aspects, including aspects relating to risk to myself and to the patient and to the other patients in the environment. So I think it's something that the college will have to deal with at one level. I think it's something which perhaps the new Association of Black Psychiatrists, but the Asians, you see, we have a very important issue in psychiatry. I think probably half of our colleagues will be from the Asian subcontinent or born of parents who are from the Asian subcontinent or Africa. Now is a big challenging proportion, and a few of us from the Caribbean. The Chinese, of course, are there too. And then we have people from the Middle East, we have people from Greece, we have people from, you know, it's a multiracial grouping. It's a tight one, it's a very tight one, but it's a challenging one.
I mean, I think you're correct. I hope you can hear me. But yes, I think, good. I think you're absolutely right. It's going to be very challenging. And I think zero tolerance is a very sensible approach. I'd be interesting, Altha, what are your thoughts? You're nodding. Look,
I'm glad that this question came up. I actually have two responses. One is from my first clinical experience as a medical student involved such an incident. And ironically, it was an older Black woman who challenged whether or not I even deserved to be there because I wasn't white, and kept insisting that she wanted the white doctor. She could say doctor, but she wanted the white doctor. And my attending put me in a white coat and hung a stethoscope around my neck and thought that was going to soothe her. And she said, baby, I'm not stupid. I'm old, but I'm not stupid. I know you're not a doctor. They can put you in anything that they want, but I still know you're not a doctor because you're a Negro. And that shows you how far back we're talking. And I was mortified, of course, because she could have been my grandmother or aunt or someone and didn't have any faith in me. Fast forward to my time as president, I traveled around a lot and I heard from residents and early career psychiatrists that these experiences were happening to them in the clinical setting and they didn't know what to do about it because no one wanted to talk about it. Mm. The concept of zero tolerance had not yet come up. And people that were teaching them at the time, and this goes back a couple of years, really thought the best thing to do was just to ignore it. And one young woman called me in tears after one episode because she kept getting sent back to see someone who repeatedly called her the N-word and refused her treatment in the emergency room. And she didn't know what to do. She couldn't, you know, back up the attending and, I mean, go after the attendant and say, I can't do this. You need to figure out another way. And it led to a discussion nationally around zero tolerance. And in some programs now, that kind of verbal assault and abuse is considered equivalent to physical assault and handled in the same way. Zero tolerance, patients are informed, this is not acceptable. If you insist, we will make arrangements for you to receive your care elsewhere.
Mm. Yeah.
It's finally come to the surface, but it took a while.
Yeah, well, it's interesting you mentioned that, actually, that thing that happens when, certainly when I was younger, I would get, you know, people who would come along and say, oh, are you the doctor? Black and white, actually. Mm-hmm. And they'd want to see the proper doctor, not me. But I would just tell them about my qualifications and then we'd sort that out. But zero tolerance, good. Zero tolerance in the US, and I think zero tolerance here too. The question is what that looks like when you've got a patient who is detained under section. Femi, if you get anything you want to add or say?
Not really. I think what Aggrey said is one of the interesting aspects of it, that it's relatively rare in the UK. That's what I'd say. So that's not to say that it doesn't happen, but it's not as common as you would imagine, and neither is it as vulgar as you might imagine. But that's not to say that it is not discomforting or uncomfortable. And I think that there's an aspect of this which hasn't been touched on, which is something to do with, if you might be putting it this way, that the African, as opposed to the African in diaspora approach. So there's a kind of willingness to ignore.
Which is just,
I'm not suggesting that it's a good attitude at all, but there's this bit of it, and I've been to meetings where there are young African medical students and young African consultants, and this question has been asked, and people want to argue, want to act as if it doesn't really happen. But I think that's something to do with the fact that those of us who are born on the continent, we don't regard ourselves as minorities. Mm. And secondly, we've got this sort of attitude, which is to say something like, it's not my country. So there's that sort of, these are just defense mechanisms that people use.
Yeah.
In order to feel able to do their work. But I think, to summarize, I think the point that's been made, that zero tolerance is the answer,
yeah.
You know, that you can't work in the circumstance where people mistreat you. Yeah. And even though these are verbal assaults, but they are as damaging as physical assaults.
Yeah, it's interesting that you've, Aggrey, and you both said you felt it was rare. I have to say, I'm not so sure that in my experience it was rare. I'd say it was pretty common. Not necessarily so much for the, I would guess it. And in fact, I think about a patient that we have at the moment who regularly calls me Black N-word, but who I get on with very well, oddly enough. But particularly for the nursing staff, and we have a lot of Black nursing staff, a lot of whom are West African heritage. And actually they get abused every day. And I would say it was actually quite common, and we do have a zero tolerance. We basically say that you can't do this, and after a while what we're going to have to do is, because you may not realize this, but it's actually an offense and we might have to call the police in. So we actually have our police support liaison officer who'll come and caution people, not caution formally, but they'll talk to people, and usually then it stops. Mosun, what are your thoughts?
Yes, so my experience is that it is not rare in the UK. It does happen. If you talk to trainees of nowadays, you find out that it does happen. And we should not underestimate the effect, the psychological trauma that people can experience and the impact it can have on your self-confidence and your self-esteem. We of the older generation might have thicker skin, and we might be of the generation where we can ignore and try and suppress it to the background. But people find it more difficult to deal with it these days, and so it should not be ignored. It's important that people do seek support. Trainees would have balance groups now, would have peer groups, peer support, we have reflective practice. So it's important that people pick it up in different settings so that they can deal with the situation when it occurs. And people should be allowed to refuse to treat the patients, because obviously there's a transference and counter transference, and the therapeutic relationship is already broken at that point in time. It can be a reason why people don't want to come into psychiatry. So when we talk about zero tolerance, sometimes feels that zero tolerance occurs in every other specialty in the UK except psychiatry. Psychiatry, we sometimes have a way of allowing things to happen because they have been, our service users have mental illness. But a service user who's followed you around when you're having your dinner, who it's not their psychosis that is driving them at that point in time. It's really important for us to be clear. If they're acutely psychotic, they're gone and they don't know what they're talking about. That's completely different from a premeditated, a patient who's got a capacity and is intentionally trying to get at you because of the color of your skin or your race. Zero tolerance in psychiatry needs to be zero tolerance, in equivalent to every other specialty in medicine. That's what I'll say.
Yeah, thank you, Mosun. Okay, so it's definitely something that is, looks like, I'm just looking at the comments, it looks like it's something that's pretty much alive, actually. And as someone, I think Rosemary has said, it is probably more common for nurses and doctors, but it's certainly still happening with doctors, definitely. And it looks like most people agree with zero tolerance. But I think maybe Aggrey said actually that something that the college needs to support with, and I'm thinking that in my role we'll have to start thinking about some guidance for people actually about what you might do, because depending on where you work in the country, it might be easier if you're in an area where there are very few Black doctors, then it might be harder for you to speak up. Or if you're in an area where there are very few Black doctors in senior positions, because I know that in my position now as a senior doctor, I'm much more able to be the one who leads this and says this is how we should behave in this situation, which actually allows people to take a zero tolerance stance, actually. So next question, I think, because of time's getting on, and this is a little bit more positive, actually, because this is, I think, as Mosun said, one of the things we might be able to do is to use the Association of Black Psychiatrists. And someone has said that until today, they'd never heard of the Association of Black Psychiatrists. And it is a new organisation, but long awaited, and we are all extremely pleased that they started it. Now, I'm going to ask Mosun if she can, maybe if you can just share a little bit of more information about it, actually.
Right, so it is my pleasure to introduce the Association of Black Psychiatrists UK. As people have already identified, it may not be widely known to everybody. And that's because we only had the inaugural meeting 7 days ago on the 22nd of October. We specifically chose the Black History Month to have the inaugural meeting because we thought that it was a significant landmark to start such an organization. If you look on the screen, kindly shared by Katie, there is a telephone number and there is also the handles. There's an email account. And there's an email address as well as a website where you can access for membership details. Please use the contact numbers on the screen. You can email that address, you can log onto the website, and we'll be glad to have you. As we said, it is for all Black psychiatrists of all grades, also intending psychiatrists, medical students. You're all welcome. Obviously, we are also forming allies with all the diaspora organizations. We're already talking to British Pakistani Psychiatric Association, British Indian Psychiatric Association, Sri Lankan, Sudan. So it's now we're gonna have international collaborations like Dr. Stewart has said. So it's really an opportunity for us to get in there and make our voices heard. You have to be at the table. It's important that you use your voice at the right time. And this is, it'll be difficult for you to try and reach individually. This is not an individual race. A collective action would bring better results than individual actions. And so we are encouraging everybody. If you want to be allied members, you're welcome as well. But please use the contact details on the screen to join the association. Thank you.
Oh, Mosun, thank you very much indeed. Very nice advert for it, actually. And I hope you're all busy signing up now. It's very cheap. Anyway, there's a question here from Dr. Felicity Zuzueta, who used to be a trauma psychiatrist, a very famous one, actually, who at the Maudsley. And what Felicity has asked is this. Dr. Altha Stewart mentioned adverse childhood experiences. This term is completely absent in psychiatry in the UK. I'm not quite sure that's completely true, Felicity, because we did have a talk about it last week. But anyway, why, when it is so useful to attend to the issues that Aggrey and Altha spoke about, do we not hear enough? Essentially, why don't we hear enough about adverse childhood experiences? Altha, any thoughts?
Well, that's a good question. And I think in part, the answer has to do with the profession of psychiatry. adverse childhood experiences grew out of work that had no connection directly at its earliest research, in its earliest research, to the field of psychiatry. It began, that phrase, that understanding, that category began out of some work that started with people recognizing patterns in general healthcare outcomes that they related to issues of childhood. As often happens, psychiatry thinks of things in the categories that we have identified. You know, childhood PTSD exists in the DSM, and PTSD as a diagnostic category exists in the ICD classifications. But from the standpoint of understanding the broader root cause, if you will, frequently we jump right to the end and decide what it is without thinking carefully about how it became. You know, since our early days as a profession with the schizophrenogenic mother and some of those issues, psychiatry just has a challenging time, I think, understanding that people are more than their symptoms of mental illness that they bring into the mental health arena. And so we're playing catch up, but I think psychiatry is starting to recognize the importance of this as we do more in the areas of collaborative care around whether it's pediatrics and mental health for children or primary care and mental health in adults. I think we're starting to play catch up. And the more that many of us talk about it, the more familiar it becomes. And people begin to see what it looks like in their adult patients. They begin to recognize how it starts with their child patients. It's just going to take some time to really build a following in the psychiatric community that appreciates it as a mental health issue.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Just very quickly, because of time, I just want to make, there's a couple of points that have come up in the chat from people, just about the racist abuse from patients and various things. So Mosun, people are asking about whether people of other backgrounds can join the Association of Black Psychiatrists. And I think you mentioned that people could be allies.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Allies.
So you don't just have to be African Caribbean or or Black African descent. Okay. And then there's another question, which is about, actually it's a similar thing from Anna saying, can white psychiatrists join? And yes, definitely, as said. There's a question from a point actually from William, who said that, you know, what about using, you know, racist abuse from patients who are, you know, to staff who are in a position of care and power in particular over them is an area where psychodynamic understanding might be useful. And I think we'd all agree with that, actually. And we all know that one of the reasons why people abuse you is to try and hurt you where they think it's going to hurt most. And racist abuse often does that. It goes to the very heart of who you are. You know, before you were anything, you were a Black person. For me, before I'm anything, I'm Black female. And that's that. And so maybe the way to hurt me most is that, but that doesn't necessarily mean to say you don't use zero tolerance. You just give them a bit more time before you actually have to take the step of saying it, you know, before you actually say we can't really treat you in the service if you're going to continue to do that. So then next question, proper one. Oh yeah, Mosu, people want to have details of the Black Women in Health Association. I'd like that as well, actually. How come you haven't asked me to join is my question. And then back to the points about adverse childhood experiences, I'm wondering if Aggrey, Femi, Mosun, if you have any thoughts about that after what Altha was saying. I just wanted to make sure that we had time to make those points. Aggrey, any thoughts about adverse childhood experiences?
Yes, thanks a lot. And Altha's view is well taken. There is a problem for us in psychiatry, however, which is that we don't recognize that social workers do half of our jobs. They are the people who actually meet this set of circumstances daily. And they have been working with it, particularly social workers with children and families, because that's what it's all about. A child going into care, a child being excluded from school, a child becoming delinquent. They have been injured. They've been traumatized. And rescuing them isn't easy. I gave a talk in Trinidad on the Zoom a couple of weeks ago on what resilience to being sexually abused. And my measure of that was, of course, to do with parasuicide. And so, you know, you can have someone who has a lot of adverse factors, but hasn't been abused in that way. And the likelihood of becoming suicidal is less. So we can look at other areas in the same way. But the point I'm making is this. In our Black community and in the community at large, counselors, psychotherapists, social workers, psychologists, educational psychologists, teachers are all part of us. We are in the same group together. We're in the same room, and we have to learn to respect each other and to respect the skills that we all bring to the pool. Because if we don't do that, our clients will drown. We can't prevent them from drowning. And so it's really important for us to outstretch and include, be more inclusive in how we see the situation.
Thank you. Femi, have you got anything you want to add? You're still muted.
Very well described, I think, by both Altha and Aggrey. There's not much more to say. Just to remind all of us, of course, that the whole business about attachment theory speaks to the same area, to the same subject. And that is relatively solidly in our subject. We all agree that attachment theory matters. So that's the only other addition that I want to make.
Okay. So on that note, what I'm going to do is thank you all.
Lade,
so
I just have.
Oh,
just
sorry, Mosun. Sorry, yeah.
About the attachment theory and it, the only thing I want to add to that is the differential uptake of psychological therapies and talking therapies amongst Blacks and BAME service users. I think there might be an assumption that Black people or BAME patients are not psychologically minded. And sometimes there's even an underlying bias with us with referral to the services, apart from the fact that they may not be accepted by the service or they may not engage. And I think it's an area that needs to be explored. Why, one, we don't refer as much to psychological services, and two, why they don't engage, and three, possibly some bias or some assumption that Black people or BAME people will not engage in psychological therapies. And I think, I'm not sure how many, just as I was saying about Black psychiatrists and female psychiatrists being visible, I'm not sure how visible Black counselors are, Black psychologists, and Black educational psychologists. And it's probably an area that needs to be developed as well in terms of workforce available to cope, to cater for the needs of the service users.
Yeah, thank you, Mosun, for mentioning that. I heard there was a big discussion about psychology and Black people last week, actually. And it's certainly a big bugbear of mine that there aren't enough Black psychologists at all. And it is a big problem that there is sometimes an assumption that Black people and Asian people and people in minority ethnic groups aren't psychologically minded, which of course is completely untrue because we spend most of our time worrying about what other people think. Anyway, certainly if you go up in the UK. All right, so I'm going to hand over to Tim, but first I want to say thank you all so much for being such inspirational people and for being so thoughtful and actually for being there so we can see what we can become. Thank you. Over to Tim.
Thank you very much, Lade. Thank you very much once again to Professor Oyebode, Dr. Fapohunda, Dr. Burke, and Dr. Stewart. It's been a riveting hour and a half, and I'm sure people from the responses on the chat line have got a lot of richness to go and reflect on. There's a survey that has been sent out at Kezia. I'd be happy if you can fill it out. And my gift as the chair to say, we bring this webinar to an end. Thank you so much and have a wonderful evening. And thank you, Altha, and hope things go well next week. Take care. Bye-bye.